get to the temple. I love to worship. Praise the Lord. Well, make sure I got this right. Can we have a word of prayer now, please? Father, again, you have called upon me and given me a task that I cannot do. But I thank you, Jesus, that you are capable. And I thank you for your Holy Ghost Spirit that you have sent to lead us through each worship. So I pray, oh Lord, that as we take a time to go into this worship service, that you now will hover over this church. You'll hover over the mind of everyone that is here, and may they take their mind off their troubles and distraction, and may their mind and their heart be in tune with heaven right now, that they're ready to receive the blessing that you so want to give us. I thank you, Father, for being with us, and I thank you now for leading and teaching us now. In Jesus' name, amen. So a lot of things have been happening lately, but before we go there, turn with me in your Bible to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, let's look at verse 13. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 13. And the Bible says, you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. This morning, we're going to talk about time to make a difference. Time to make a difference. So you must have noticed a lot of things that's been happening on the planet. A lot of severe hurricanes destroying right through the Caribbean, right through the United States. A lot of life has been lost, you know. We have been hearing also about all this earthquake that has been hit next door in Mexico, steadily coming, it's steadily coming. Earthquake, storm, famine, war, this thing doesn't seem to come to an end. It just keeps happening. It's very sad. It's very heartbreaking. And every time we hear these things happening, we get a nice explanation from the secular world and from the scientists, because right away they like to come to the conclusion that we're going through some climate changes. But I'd like to look at it from a biblical perspective. I believe that all these things that are really happening is signs of the time. Signs of the time. And all these things that are happening, the planet is announcing the return of our Savior. So I believe all this that are happening, and it's getting worse. It's not getting any better, if you notice. We just thought we were done in Mexico, and they got hit again. When I heard the news yesterday, they had over 200 people that died from this last earthquake that hit them. And I keep wondering, why are they still fooling the people? Well, the Bible is very clear about that. I'm talking the governments and all that. Because if you look at Psalms 14, verse 1 to 3, Psalms chapter 14, verse 1 to 3, the Bible gives us the answer why they keep trying to fool the people. They don't want the people to know what is really happening. And the Bible says in verse 1 to 3 that these people that are doing this, the Bible says, Psalms 14, verse 1 to 3, the fools have said in their heart, there is no God. So all of these men, the Bible called them fools. Why? Because they have been denying God for so long, so it's hard for them to come to terms with these things that are happening are biblical prophesied event that is announcement for the soon return of Jesus Christ. You see, we hate to be wrong, human beings. We like to be right all the time, but we all cannot be right. Somebody have to be wrong. So I believe in the word of God, and I believe that they're wrong. If you listen, if you read Matthew 24, and you look at verse 6 to 8, you will see Jesus explaining about these last day events that is happening, because we are in the last legal race of earth history, and Jesus called this whole thing birth pain. Now us men, we never experience birth pain, but if you ever seen your wife or a friend or a family going through it, you can know that it's not a fun thing. As a matter of fact, the birth pain comes in different stages. You know, you have the 1 hour, 2 hours apart pain, so it's not so bad. You know, like I said to my wife, honey, she grabbed her stomach. I said, what's the matter? Oh, bird pain. I said, okay. And you want to go to the doctor? She said, no, it's okay. It's 2 hours apart. But when that bird pain started hitting 5 minutes, like every 5 minutes, she said, hey, time to grab the bag. We go into the doctor. And we are know for sure that something is going to happen when it even get closer to 1 minute apart. The baby is coming. So when the planet is doing all this stuff, Jesus called it simple birth pain. And as the birth pain gets more severe and gets worse, we know that the Lord is going to be bursting out of the eastern sky. So don't get confused. And another thing, don't get scared. Don't be afraid. It's just sad what we see happening. But the Lord do not want you to be afraid. If you read John chapter 14, verse 1 to 3, the Bible says, let not your heart be troubled. Only believe in God and trust in the word of God. So do not be afraid. Pray for our neighbors and our friends, all these people that are going through all this trauma and homelessness and heartache and pain. It's terrible. A lot of us here are kind of more laid back because we're not going through this in Calgary, but believe you me, Calgary gonna be going through its own portion of bird pain. It might not be hurricane, but it's coming too. It's coming too. Because the Lord wants us and he tells us that these things are going to be happening. So do not be afraid, only believe, trust in the word of God that these things have to come to pass. And another thing, it's time for us to really do something. I don't have a lot of time. It will not be a long sermon. I'm going to be going fast. It's going to be a sermon. Welcome my senior pastor and your lovely wife, Sister Kathy. We're glad you're here to worship with us this morning. Pastor Harrell, I love you, man. Now, it's time for us to do something, though. Because we cannot just go see these things happening, and in our heart, we just say, well, I will pray for you. Because I notice a lot of good Christian brethren of mine, when things are happening to people, I will pray for you, but they won't actually do anything other than that. We have to get involved in doing something. Because time is running out for everyone, not just for church brothers and sisters, but the people outside in the community that are not saved yet. Time is running out for them. So it's time for us now, as good Christian, and the Bible calls us the salt of the earth, to do something. We need to start seriously, reach out to our brethren, and make them aware of the time. Let them not get caught up in the climate change teaching from the secular world. Let them come to terms with the biblical perspective of what really going on. So we need to do something. We need to really become salt of the earth. We need to have some Christian boldness before it's too late for both us and them. Climate change is not the answer. Things are happening. Things are happening. The Bible says the Bible says that we are going through birth pain. And I like what it says in John chapter 10, verse 15 to 17, that Jesus did not just die for us that are in the church, but he died for the entire human race. So we really need to do something for them. As I will read a little bit of the scripture here, John 10, verse 15 to 17. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have which are not of this fold, this family. Them also I will bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. So there are still people out there that time is running out on, right now as we speak. People that should have been filling up this church, enjoying communion service with us as we worship and praise Jesus Christ and do this communion in remembrance of him. We need to do something. There's no more time for us to lay back, take it easy. Time is not on our side. You see, there's an invitation that is being given to all human race. An invitation from God himself. Revelation 19 verse 9, the Bible says that he said to me, write, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true saying of God. So there's another supper that is coming. Not just this supper of communion. There's a bigger one coming that we all trying to make it to. And that one will be in heaven. So we need to start seriously be concerned about our brothers and sisters as they are still out there. They're still out there and they need to come into a good relationship with God. We can't make excuses anymore. We seriously have to do something, because if God keep calling on us to help and we keep hardening our heart, we might miss that supper. We might miss that supper. Keep moving along. God is only looking for a few good men and women. He's asking for some volunteer. We all in the Christian army. And he's asking you to go out there and do something different now. He's asking you this communion service to try to get more people to join us for the next communion service that are ready for his soon return. He's looking for a few good men. You know, and a few good women. We cannot leave out the woman, because I believe heaven will be filled with more them than men. I have noticed the church have more women than men over the years. I'm a new Christian. I believe we're going to be outnumbered, not just on the planet here, but in heaven as well. Because I find that the woman, you know, I heard a pastor said it before. He said a woman is the hardest person to convert. But when she stepped in and surrendered to God, she's the strongest in the faith. Kind of believe it a little bit. It's hard to convert the ladies, but when they come, there's no turning back. So we are looking for some volunteer in this Christian army when this church is over, moving forward. Because there's a lot of people out there that the time is running out and that we need to help them. I will read a little bit from our good sister. I enjoy reading her writing so much that I don't think I've ever preached a sermon and I do not have a little bit of Sister White writing. And this is what she said. She says, what a life work was it that of these noble Hebrews men, you know, men of God, as they bade farewell to their childhood home, how little did the dream of their high destiny. Faithful and steadfast, they yield themselves to the divine guiding so that through them God could fulfill his purpose. So God has a plan for each and every one of us. If we surrender, there will be some divine guiding that we will be able to win some soul, right? The same mighty truth that was revealed through these men, God desired to reveal them through the youth. He's calling on the youth and the children. He's calling on the children and, of course, us adopted parents, the children of today. So I believe there's a mighty work for the kids to do as well. The history of Joseph and Daniel is an illustration of what he will do for those who yield themselves to him with the whole heart, with that whole heart to seek to accomplish God's purpose, his purpose. And listen to this now. The greatest want of the world is the want of men and women who will not be bought or sold. No one can buy you if you seriously have a relationship with God. You will not sell out. You will stand firm to the end. Who will not be bought or sold? Men and women who in their inmost soul are true and honest. God is looking for a few honest men and a few honest women. Men and women who do not fear to call sin. You're not afraid to call sin by its right name. Men and women whose conscience is as true to duty as the knee to the pole. Needle to the pole. Men who will stand and women for the right, for right, though the heavens fall. God is asking for a few good volunteers, few good Christian men and women that are ready to stand to the end in the last leg of the race right now to do something to save another sin-sick soul. Because we all just sin-sick soul. And we're in the right place. You know, the church is just a hospital for sin-sick soul. Sin-sick soul is simple. Sick human being. We're all just broken. But such a character is not the result of accident. It is not due to special favors or endowment of providence. A noble character is the result of self-discipline, of the subjection of the Lord to the iron nature, the service to the service of love to God and love to men. We need to start loving one another a little bit better. We need to do something different moving forward after this communion service. And as I said, I didn't come here to give you a long sermon. We come for a communion service. Well, brothers and sisters, and the youth and children, believers in Jesus Christ this morning, we are the salt of the earth. Let's give it flavor. We are the soldiers in God's army. We need to be bold and strong in sharing our faith. Time is running out for the saved as much as the unsaved. Matthew 5 verse 13 says, you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled on the foot by men. Time for us to make a difference, brethren. Time for us to stop making excuses. Time is not on our side. All the signs are there. The Lord is on his way.